today we were going to talk about some impacts of the COVID-19 on utilities and what some utilities are tracking to determine the impact. I want to thank Ramona. She sent me some data that was really useful. The National League of Cities did a survey of their members, and then Ramona, Missouri Municipal League, pulled out the Missouri data out of that. It was very, very informative. So I am going to share that with you so you can see what that data was. Hang on. Okay. Can everybody see that?
Yes.
Hang on. Let me get rid of some of the stuff here. Okay. So this is from the National League of Cities survey and the Missouri information pulled out. And basically, and I'll scroll it down here too, 92% of the Missouri municipalities that participated in anticipated impact from COVID-19 shortfalls. When you look at those first two numbers, you know, that's 76% expect a 20% or less 20% or down impact on revenue. So I thought that was significant for municipalities. Now, water districts probably aren't as impacted because a lot of this, if you look on further down, most of that impact is from reduction in sales taxes. And that really hasn't hit, I think in Missouri and you municipalities, correct me if I'm wrong, those come out every quarter. So the April, May, June sales taxes aren't going to come in until July to these municipalities. And that's where, you know, from the businesses shut down and that type of thing, that's where you're going to see that impact. So it's kind of a delayed reaction, but 22% of the utility fees are going down. 21% is permitting fees. I'm assuming that's building permits, that type of thing. So that's pretty significant. And then over on the right hand side, it talks about what is going to be impacted, what city functions. 70% say the police force is going to be impacted, the police budget. 65% parks and rec. And that makes sense when you look at this list, because a lot of these, you know, police, parks, fire, they're sales tax. A lot of them are sales tax based. So that kind of makes sense that those are the services that would be impacted. So what are they going to do? 87% said they're going to draw down their reserves to meet that shortfall. Over half of them are going to cut services. A third of them are going to increase their fees. 19% are going to increase taxes. That'll be interesting to see, because in Missouri, I think you have to have a vote to do that. 18% are going to lay off. So, you know, several ways, and some of those I assume are going to do a combination of these. So the primary factor driving municipality shortfalls are attributed to unanticipated revenue declines and unanticipated revenue declines and expenditures increases. So that's kind of an interesting little summary of some of the things that they anticipate.
And Liz, if yeah, I Ramona. Can, National League of Cities just closed out a survey yesterday, another one. So hopefully within a week or so, we'll have more data to show more current stuff as well. But they just sent it out again, and we sent it to all our members.
Okay. That would be good, because I think this is going to be a delayed reaction to this. I know we had a similar discussion a couple of weeks ago when we had our last one, and most of them on the line were water districts, and they were seeing no impact. But I think as we go along, you know, some of this is delayed. So National Rural Water Association also did a survey. Now, it was national, and I just have some general nationwide numbers, but National Rural Water anticipated that utilities, water and wastewater, would have a $998 million loss by mid-July because of COVID-19. And primarily impacted are those utilities and those communities that were, a lot of them were tourism-based, travel-based, or had huge users that had to be shut down, and that was a lot of their usage. So some of those were unique. 37% said their revenue loss was due to non-payment of bills by customers. So collections were down by 22%. And this was taken in like maybe the 1st of May. So it'd be interesting to get that updated. I don't know if National Rural Water is going to do another survey. So, you know, talking about how do you measure the impact when it's kind of delayed, what are the things you need to look for? I was talking with Mary West, and Mary's with us today from Moberly, and some of the things that they are looking at as far as the water and wastewater. And so I asked Mary to come on today and talk about what are they tracking in Moberly in anticipation of being ready for the impact. So Mary, do you want to talk a little bit about what you're tracking there in Moberly?
Sure. So I just made a few notes so I'd keep myself on track, because otherwise I get kind of lost in in the weeds here. But so in order for us to track revenues, since we bill basically 30 to 45 days in arrears, you know, we don't always see it in the bills going out. And I wanted to know what was happening right now. So I started looking at what our demand was at the water plant. Because I figured if the water demand was going down, then I knew in a month or two that we were going to see reduced revenue. So it looks like we lost about 100,000 gallons a day of demand because schools were closed, restaurants were closed, things like that. Obviously, you know, it's not only the kids in Moberly that go to school here. We bring folks in from out of the county, people working at home who may not live within the corporate limits of the city as our customers, working from home, so they weren't using water at the offices, things like that. So 100,000 gallons a day translates to about $112,000 a quarter for Moberly in water and sewer revenue. So when you multiply that by four, that's a considerable sum of money over a year's period of time. Since the governor has reopened things and said, you know, everybody can kind of go back to whatever normal is going to be, you know, we kind of anticipate some of that coming back. But, you know, Moberly Community College is looking at more online classes. I believe Central Christian is going to have in-person classes in the fall, so that will bring folks back to the campus. But, you know, right now, I don't think any of us really knows. And so one of the things that we're looking at is in our budget that we are in the process of approving right now is we cut some of the revenues from the fiscal year that we were in right now, scaled back on purchases, delayed purchase of a vehicle, things like that. The city manager instituted a hiring freeze until we knew what to kind of expect and see, especially with sales tax and things like that. The utilities department is funded partially by a half-cent capital improvement sales tax that brings in about $1.2 million a year in a normal situation. But our sales tax revenues have been flat anyway or slightly declining because of all of the online shopping. And so what I know is it takes about 90 days to make a new habit. And everybody has been shopping online now for about that period of time. And so the concern is how much of that shopping is going to come back local. And that does impact our sales taxes. So Moberly is fortunate that we do have a use tax, but I'm just kind of waiting to see what what our sales tax revenue looks like, because you're right, Liz, that is a quarterly thing. We had a lot of people shopping in March and April, you know, buying toilet paper or whatever. And so the sales tax revenues for this past period were actually up a little bit, but I really don't, I don't think that we will continue to see that level of capital improvement sales tax. Ramona, to answer your question, we don't meter wastewater. So it is drinking water loss. That's how we bill. I wish I could meter wastewater, because we treat about three times the amount of wastewater as we do drinking water here. Our daily demand at the water plant is about 1 million gallons a day, and we've been running 3 million gallons a day through the wastewater plant. Such is the nature of a combined sewer community. But so as far as customers go, we did see, we stopped doing shutoffs in March for delinquent payments, non-payment of bills. Many people called, made payment arrangements, were working with us. Many of them did not. We continued to do door tags and encourage people to do that. We had one customer write us a check for a penny. Obviously, that was not a serious effort to stay current. We have several who have not paid anything at all since we stopped doing disconnects. So some of the customers, we have one customer with a $700 utility bill, water, sewer, and trash. And so that's the concern, is letting people get that far behind. How do they ever get caught up? We also hold landlords responsible for the bill jointly and severably. So the landlords were very getting very concerned about this extended no shutoffs. So we are going to resume shutoffs for non-payment on the 29th of June. We have given everybody notice, sent letters. The landlords know that we're going to go back and do that. But because the courts were also closed, landlords were not able to evict people who were not paying utility bills or not paying rent. And so now the landlords are doubly impacted, because if we hold them responsible for the water bill, they weren't receiving rent during this time. And so it is going to be interesting to, we have a decision to make about how we're going to do that for some of these landlords who have more than 100 units in Moberly. So that's still up in the air. That question came in yesterday. As far as projects go, as we talked about, Moberly just passed a bond issue, an extension of our capital improvement sales tax. We did not start any projects until that bond election was held, because honestly, we weren't sure how those projects were going to be funded, or if we were going to have to delay those until we could figure that out. There is a lot of delayed maintenance in Moberly, as there is in most communities. We've done a lot of work, but there's still a lot to be done as far as pipeline assets. So right now I am working on putting together the capital improvement plan since the bond issue just passed, so that we can get that into the budget for this coming fiscal year for those projects that should be moving forward. Staffing, as I said, the city manager put a hiring freeze on. At the time he did that, I still have 4 open positions, 1 at the wastewater plant. We've had a position open for more than a year. It's very hard to find people with operator experience, especially we're looking for someone with pretreatment experience. And it's just hard finding someone that wants to move and take on a position like that, especially at the pay scale that we're able to offer. I have 3 positions open in my field crew. That crew right now is 10 people. It's normally 13. So that means that the guys are taking call more often and working longer hours to get projects accomplished, because we just don't have enough boots on the ground. And so, during the COVID-19, you know, with all the social distancing and nobody was sure how it was transmitted or who had it or all of that. It was very taxing, I think, on the crew to be to still be out there every day fixing water leaks, jetting sewer mains, that kind of thing. And so I really need to give a lot of credit to those who did that. We did take precautions, but, you know, it is still working on the field crew is not something you can do from home on a computer. So they still needed to be out and in the community. And honestly, some customers were very appreciative and some customers were, how can you be out here? You should be at home. So, you know, we got all kinds of reactions from the public. As far, one of the things I think that's probably hardest for me is the forecasting piece. How do we forecast what the revenues are going to do? How do we forecast what staffing levels we're going to need? The new, and I don't know if the governor has signed it yet, but the Water Safety and Security Act, I think it is, that was passed for Missouri that's going to require us to do all of the valve exercising and mapping and all of that repair and flush every hydrant and test every hydrant every year. That's going to take some staff. And, you know, I don't know that I've got the staff on board right now to get that done and what it's going to look like and how we certify that to DNR. Looking at debt service for borrowing, what funds are going to be available through the SRF. I think it's going to be pretty competitive. And so, you know, just looking at that and how we can maximize our points so that we score well and get on that funding list, tracking revenues, estimating that, and then being able to tell the story to the city council. We have banking type folks on our city council, and so they really kind of dive into the numbers and ask good questions. And so I need to make sure that we've done our homework and can answer all of those questions so that they're comfortable with signing on the dotted line to say, yes, we're going to borrow this much money and we believe that the utilities department has the means to pay that back. And then just tracking expenses and what that's going to do over time. Our health insurance costs are going up quite a bit, and knowing how to forecast that, and it, whether it's employee expenses, chemical expenses, electric expenses, you know, when you're looking at 20 or 30 year debt, all of that goes into that equation. So I really have been, I struggled with that for a while, found some interesting software that I've been working with that helps me with that. And kind of really puts it all in a graph that the council can understand, the city manager can understand, and helps me explain why we need the cash flow and why we need reserves and all of that kind of stuff. So we're also in the middle of a big meter change out and we're changing our billing software. So there's a lot of stuff going on.
Wow.
So that's kind of the rundown, I guess.
Well, just the meter and the billing software is a huge effort.
Yes.
For lack of a better term, but to combine it with everything else. So Mayor, do you know, can you tell us how much, besides the, you know, the reduction in flows, right? You said 100,000 gallons a day, less water sold or produced, mm-hmm. rather produced, but your delinquency rate probably went up
quite a bit. It did. I mean, I have to give the girls in the office credit because they have been making phone calls. They've been doing the door tags and just holding people to payment arrangements. But our delinquency rate right now, we had some even larger customers that were not paying on time. Some of that I think was due to corporate offices in New York or things like that where people were not going to work for a while. We have reached out to those folks and gotten them current. We have one mobile home park that owes us $2,000, hasn't paid us since February. They're master metered. So, you know, right now I think we're probably sitting on maybe $25,000 worth of delinquencies, which at one point we were up over 40. It's wow. not as bad as it could have been. But, you know, Moberly has a lot of low income residents. Our median household income is under 35,000. And so we just try and manage that delinquency so that we try, because the landlords can't afford it, most of them, or don't want to. And you know, the customers certainly can't, and they can't move into another place and start over with a clean slate, because we hold them to that unpaid bill if they come back and sign back up for service. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's just, it's one of those things that we track. And some years I've seen the delinquencies, the uncollectible accounts, up over $100,000 for the whole year. And, you know, that's a 1% rate increase. So, you know, I hate to spread that cost out for everyone else, but I honestly, I know that that's what the for-profits are doing for the ones who have said, oh, we're not turning people off. They are tracking those costs and will wrap that into their next rate increase before the Public mm-hmm. Service Commission.
Right. So. Right. So it's kind of a double hit. You sold it, but you can't collect it. So
right.
besides the reduction in sales, you've got the reduction in collections. And so you've yeah. got a double hit. And that's something I don't know that everybody understands. You've got to track both sides of that. Mm-hmm. And so what do? You know, if you've got, like you said, a customer who's racked up a bill of over $700, how do they, mm-hmm. so when you reconnect, Mary, you're requiring them to pay in full or to, with instituting your disconnect policy back, do they have to pay the current?
No, they'll have to pay the delinquent amount.
Okay.
We'll let them not pay the current amount. And that's always been like that. We've talked about making them pay the current and the past. But like I said, most customers struggle to even get the delinquent amount. And, mm-hmm. you know, it's, we can talk about why people make the decisions they make, but, you know, even with the stimulus money and all of that, people didn't come in and get caught up on their bills, but Walmart was pretty busy. So, that's evidenced by the sales tax mm-hmm. receipts. So, you know, at some point, do all of the customers who were paying their bills also pay for those who were not? And so that's why we try and enforce that. But we have, for people who are truly in a dire situation and can document that, we will set them up on payment arrangements if they will come in and sign, you know, a formal document that says, yes, I agree to this, so that if something happens and they're not paying, then we have that fall back on for the city attorney or whoever. But it's not going to be, we're just going to let you string us along for a while. It's mm-hmm. it's time. Hey, Ramona.
Oh, hi. Quick point. We're still waiting to hear on officially, but we've heard rumor. And we're waiting for confirmation that supposedly CARES money could be used for utilities that are missing that money. So we'll keep everybody up on that one. I've also heard from Missouri Housing Commission that they can sometimes tap into, there's been a bunch of funds available for those who can't pay their rent, which may include utilities. And I can get that information to Liz and to others, but those are two options that we're waiting to hear on. Well, again, that the rental one, supposedly there's money out there that those who can't pay their utilities and can't pay their rent, they go to this housing commission and show them, and then they would contact the city and say, all right, how much are they delinquent? And supposedly that's another way you can get your money. So, and the CARES one we're waiting to hear on. So I'll send that to Liz.
Okay. I'm tracking the CARES stuff in Randolph County. That money went to the county commission. Mm-hmm. And so the county commission gets to decide how that money is spent. And so the commission is not administering those funds. That's going through the Mark Twain Regional Council of Governments. The county commission said that they released $1 million to Mark Twain, and that their priority, they have a priority, I guess, list, and the money is first earmarked for health department and medical type of expenses or COVID related stuff. So, you know, that's about a little over a third of the money that the county received. And I'm just not sure how we tap into that at this point.
You may want to check with the Regional Planning Commission. Mm-hmm. And see if, because they had the federal government decided how that money will be spent, and then it's supposed to go down to the state and county. So that's hopefully where they got their marching orders from, was the feds. And so I would check with them on reimbursement for utilities and see if.
Right. Yeah.
Again, I've heard rumor, but I haven't seen it come to fruition yet. Mostly because of what you're saying, Mary, that the money really hasn't been dispersed yet.
Right. We've encouraged our membership because of the money that went to the counties, and the counties are to disperse it out. And you know, we've heard some feedback from some counties who really didn't know what they were going to spend it on. They got so much that, you know, I think they were thinking pretty narrowly that, well, you know, we've got to spend it on buying masks. Well, you know, $1 million will buy a lot of masks. But I think we encouraged our membership to at least contact your county commission and let them know that there's other costs as a result of this that need to be considered. So, you know, and I'm going to say that again, is talk to your county commission, tell them, you know, hey, here's an impact that you may not have thought of, because I don't know that county commissions automatically think of water and wastewater utilities, because it's not what they do, you know, it's not what they fund. And I agree that probably the emphasis is on health departments and emergency responders and that type of thing. But, you know, there may be some money there. So, like Mary, you're talking about your landlords having, with the courts down and everything else, you know, their hands were really tied on what they could do. So might be worth a discussion if that's what you have in your system to talk about. Interesting kind of a flip on what Mary was seeing at Moberly with the decrease was, talked with a water district just the other day, and they have had a different experience. They purchase all of their water for resale, but their purchases went up. They were buying more water by about 10% more, but their water loss increased. It went from around 10 or 15% up to 25% water loss. But they were residential. And I said, well, buying more water makes sense because everybody's at home, right? Schools are out. Everybody's working from home. So, and they serve a residential, customer base. So they were buying a lot more water, but their water loss was a lot higher. We were talking and I said, well, I said, how about your meters? Well, they do a meter changeout program. And I said, well, okay, but you need to look at, you know, maybe portions of your system, if you can, and they do, they have their system, I guess, metered off to where they can look at areas, you know, and what went through where. Because I said, if you're buying more, that makes sense. But if you're selling, if you're not selling it, then it's going somewhere. And I would suspect a lot of it's in old meters. Even though they had a meter change out, she said, there's probably 20% of their meters that aren't, that are pretty old. And I said, well, you need to look at those. So they were kind of scratching their head, and I gave her some tips on what to look at and what to analyze. And I may have to may go up there and help them, but it was just the opposite. They were buying more water. And I asked her, I said, are you selling more water? Well, she hadn't looked at that number. I said, well, you got to look at that number and then see what the difference is.
How are they reading the meters? Are they like the customers read their own meters or?
No.
They have meter readers.
They have meter readers. They read the meters. And they read the master meter the same days that they read the meters. So it's not a timing issue so much either. Mm-hmm. Cause I thought that was maybe it, mm-hmm. but it wasn't. So to me, they've either got a leak mm-hmm. or leaks or they've got old meters that aren't registering. And with the increased use, you know, maybe they have a bunch of them that were just registering slow and mm-hmm. nobody thought anything of it. Now they're using more water and it's under registering. I would suspect that's the problem, but this provided an opportunity to bring that out and kind of mm-hmm. bring it to the light and do some analysis of their system to see what's going on there. So kind of just the opposite mm-hmm. really of what you were seeing there in Moberly. So
yeah.
So the other thing I think this brings to light, and again, I think some of this is going to hit 2 or 3, 4 months down the road. And this is something I preach to systems when I do rate studies, is the importance of reserves. Mm-hmm. And so many systems, and I see the ones that ask for a rate study, and by the time they ask me for a rate study, 90% of them are behind the eight ball anyway, right? And when I get done with the rate study, I'm not talking a little 5% raise. We're talking 20, 25, 50% rate increase because they didn't do anything and they waited till the very end. And they've spent all their money. And so they have no reserves. And then something like this hits when you've got delayed revenues coming in because you did a no disconnect policy during the emergency. And now they have nothing to live on. They're running on empty. So if nothing else, it really puts into perspective the importance of having those reserves. And I tell everybody, you need at least 3 to 6 months mm-hmm. of operating expenses in reserve, and that's a minimum. And I think a lot of that falls on deaf ears, but this kind of really brought it home for some systems. And then just how fragile the revenue stream can be, you know, with all of this.
So. The eye-opening moment for me in my career about that and about the necessity of reserves was the Joplin tornado. And I know that Joplin is a Missouri American system, but, you know, I always think if it were me, how would I handle this? Mm-hmm. And so if a major tornado came through Moberly and took out, you know, 20% of our customers, we weren't able to bill for a while. And, you know, many of those customers left and did not come back. So you still have to run the water plant. You still have staff. You have to do all of those things. So that really was my moment where I sat down and said, okay, what would we do if, you know, and it was pretty sobering. So we're serious about keeping 25% reserve for operating and maintenance expenses. And we have an equipment replacement account as required by DNR, and that reserve is built up. But, you know, it's absolutely true. You don't know what disaster lays on the horizon, and it behooves us to be responsible and plan for that.
Mm-hmm. And it's hard to get people to understand that. And boards, one of the things they don't understand, the cost of things. I don't think board members don't, they don't have a clue. And they wouldn't, you know, it's not their business day to day. So they don't know. I can't tell you how many systems I've gone in to do a rate study. And the reason, one of the major reasons is because they need to paint their water tower and they don't have any money to do that. And then I tell them, well, it's going to cost you between $100,000 and $200,000 to paint that tower. They are flabbergasted. Mm-hmm. And I said, so you can't raise rates and raise that much money in 1 year. You can't do it. Mm-hmm. So it's a lack of planning, a lack of knowledge. And you've got to start building those reserves, and they become critical. And so I think that's important and something I preach all the time. Unfortunately, we don't always make that connection. Mm-hmm. You know, another system, this was a water district, but similar to Joplin, Mary wiped out, was Mississippi number one down in Mississippi County when the, is it the Bird's Eye levee broke a number of years ago during the floods. It wiped out half of their water district. And most of those people did not come back. So they lost almost half of their customer base. And that's pretty tough. Permanently lost them. And when you've got debt that you have to pay, that makes it especially tough. So there's, you know, those situations that you really, as a board, need to sit down and think about, as management need to sit down and think about. Are you prepared to weather the storm, so to speak? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, very critical.
Yeah.
And when the board comes and meets for an hour a month or 2 hours a month, you know, it's hard to get them to see that big picture stuff, but it's really critical. Anybody else have anything they want to share? Questions? This is a quiet bunch. Mary, I wanted you to talk about too. One thing that Moberly did, and I commend them for this, during all of this, you know, the elections were postponed until June 2nd, and Moberly had two issues on the ballot. One was a bond issue. One was an extension of a sales tax. Is that right, Mary?
Yeah.
And you would have thought, oh man, what great timing, right?
I did think, oh, what great timing.
Yeah, it was a big bond issue. It was like
$18 million
bond issue, and you're thinking, oh man, that doesn't have a snowball's chance, right? Mm-hmm. It not only passed, it passed overwhelmingly. Mm-hmm. And so how did you do that, Mary, during a pandemic and everybody's you know, not paying their bill, and get them to approve spending $18 million and going into debt? So what did you do?
Well, it still kind of gives me goosebumps. So obviously we didn't start, you know, the original election was scheduled for April. We didn't start in March. I had been talking to the council and the news media and the public about the need for a rate increase and a bond election since January of 18, January 19. So we had put a plan together that I felt was pretty aggressive. The city council, once we heard from the financial advisor and DNR about the low interest rates, the council was very supportive of getting this on the ballot so that we could access the low interest money. But then, you know, it's up to us as staff to sell this to the public. And so we just started laying out our case. We had a major water leak in town that dropped the pressure in the whole community. I didn't plan it, but I definitely took advantage of that story as it unrolled and in the months after that to point out that we have infrastructure buried that is at the tipping point of failure. And that when that happens, it affects everybody in town. not just the people who live on that one section of line who might have been connected. So it really was just building that community information campaign. I put out a talking points document for internal staff so that when someone brought it up sitting around the Thanksgiving table or whatever, people knew why we were asking for it, what we were asking for. We talked to the Chamber of Commerce. We met with some of the business leaders in town. Just really talked to everybody I could think of. We couldn't do the service organizations normally. You know, you make the circuit of the Rotary and the Kiwanis and all of that to talk about the proposals, but they weren't meeting because of COVID. And so we developed a packet that we could send out to members via email. Many of the organizations did that. We had some advocates in the community that were posting comments on our behalf. Obviously, we can't ask the public to vote for an issue like this. All we can do is educate. But other people in the community can say, this is really important. You need to get to the to the polls and vote for this. And so I think that helped. We had a highly contested race for school board, which brought people to the polls or out for absentee voting. I think that helped. I really was humbled. I think that you have to develop a level of trust in the community. A couple of people told me, you know, they asked me questions one-on-one and said, well, you know, if you say we need this, then I'm going to vote for it because I trust you. That is extremely humbling. And if you can get to that point in your community where people see you as a trusted advisor instead of just someone who runs the utility, that helps.
Mm-hmm. Agree. I so often run into places where they need to do work, but they don't want to put a bond issue on because it won't pass. And they've already defeated themselves before they ever let the customers or the voters have their say. And, you know, I've always been a firm believer in communication and education. And if you lay, as Mary stated, tell your story, lay out the facts, be transparent about it. Here's what we need. Here's why we need it. Answer their questions. I mean, mm-hmm. if you don't know, tell them, I don't know, but I will find out. Mm-hmm. They may not like it, but 90% of the time they'll make the right decision. Mm-hmm. And you would be surprised at how many bond issues will pass. Now, you know, so I think it can't be overstated that, you know, you shouldn't be afraid of bond issues. And if you need one, you need one. You know, have your game plan in place. Don't just vote and say, yeah, we'll put it on there, and then that's the only thing you do. Mm-hmm. It takes a lot of effort. You've really got to inform your public and let them know what's going on. And
social media is a really big piece. We had some people get on and start, you know, the negative comments and, you know, things that were taken out of context and things like that. And what I have found, you know, a lot of communities say, oh, we don't engage with people, you know, we're not getting into that. But what I found is if you go out and put out that rumor or that falsehood in the beginning when it's still just smoldering, you can't wait till it's flaming, because then you cannot control it. If you get out there, get the truth out and get, you know, that answered, and it just becomes a non-issue and the comments stop. And so we did that on a number of different comments, and you know, I had all kinds of people helping me watch the social media outlets, so that it's like, Mary, have you seen this? And then we go out and we say, well, you know, that's not quite the way this works. And you have to be tactful and mm-hmm. everything about your comments, but you know, and just keep getting the facts out there and keep answering questions. You know, really, I think that helps a lot.
Yeah.
A whole lot.
I think it does. And whatever you do, if you're going to do an education campaign, make sure you run it by your financial advisor and your bond counsel, because you can get yourself into a pickle pretty quick if you don't do that. So I always urge everybody, whatever you, especially print material, or any articles that you're going to put in the paper, you know, if you write an article, run it by your bond counsel first to make sure you don't cross the line of promoting instead of educating, because that can throw a monkey wrench in the whole thing. So make sure you do that. But I think it's critical. And I think, you know, you'd be surprised. The public will do the right thing most of the time, as long as they understand why and what's needed. So so I thought it was great that, you know, in an election that got postponed in the middle of a pandemic, it passed by like 3/4 or something, Mary.
Yeah.
It was huge.
Almost 80% on the bond issue.
Yeah, 80% on the bond issue. So, you know, it can be done. And I give Mary a lot of that credit. She really used her Moberly team to get that done. So so it'll be good to see the projects that come out of that. So,
I'm excited.
Is that a water and wastewater?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we're about out of time. We've got a few minutes. I want this to end in a little longer than an hour. So now's your chance. If anybody has any questions or comments, feel free to unmute yourself or type me a message. Anybody got anything else? So Ramona, you're going to send me some information. So if you want something like that, send me an email and I will forward it to you. egrove@moruralwater.org. The other thing I want to, since we're nobody else has anything on this, I want to put a little.
I do have one thing, Liz. I'm sorry, I just didn't want to butt in too much. We recently had a webinar with Hannah Humphrey from DNR and Phil Wilsock from Burns and Mac on some maybe funding that may be available now. You know, Mary mentioned, gosh, it's such a difficult time. Who's thinking about moving forward with projects? Probably not a lot of people. So this is kind of looking at, well, maybe we ought to be looking because there's money out there maybe, or some opportunities available. So I can send you a link to that free webinar also.
Okay, that would be,
send out.
Yeah, that would be good. Yeah, there is, I know there's money in the SRF program and USDA also has money. There's talk of Mary and I were talking about this just prior to starting the webinar the meeting here. There's a good chance that Congress is going to pass another stimulus infrastructure package. They're looking for that. And that'll put some more money out there for infrastructure projects. And, you know, if you've got a bond issue passed, which is usually the big hurdle, right? If you've already got your bond issue passed, if not, if you've got an engineering report, you're going to move to the top of the list as far as, you know, I hate to say the word shovel ready because that's, everybody kind of rolls their eyes, but you're going to be further ahead. And just so I was talking to Hannah earlier this week, last week they closed on an SRF loan and the interest rate was 0.8% was the interest rate on that loan. So interest rates are really good right now, and they do have the money. And there is some grant money there, but you're not going to get 100% grant money. So it's not going to happen. I had a system call me last week, and they need an $8 million project and wouldn't know where they could get grant money for it. I said, well, I've got news for you. It's not going to happen. And again, they were the ones that didn't want to put a bond issue on the ballot. I said, well, I don't know what else to tell you. That's what you're going to have to do. There is money out there. So, but it takes, there's a lot of hoops. That's true. But it's very, very, very good interest rates right now. Very good terms. So something to think about. Next thing, MRWA, we are going to do board and council training via Zoom. For those of you that have board members who do not want to take a day off of work and come to a meeting somewhere, we're going to do 3 nights, 2 hours each session of board and council training. That's on our website. It's limited registration, so we're going to limit the numbers. So if that's something you're interested in, or some of your board members might be interested in, take a look at that on our website at moruralwater.org and get signed up. I think we've got probably 5 or 6 signed up already, and we put it up yesterday. So, but we were going to try it to see, you know, those board members who work or can't get away or don't want to travel, a virtual board training. We're going to see how it goes. And if it goes well, we may do some more. So
Liz, does that count on the SRF points for board and council training?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah. And it's a 6-hour course. It's going to be over the course of 3 nights. So you have to attend all 3 nights to get your certification.
Okay.
But yes, it counts for points on your SRF.
Okay. All right.
But you can go to our website and look at more, and I think on the website it even has the specific topics we're going to cover each night. So we'll see how that goes, but we're limiting it to 20 participants. So if it's something you want to do, I would encourage you to get them signed up sooner rather than later. We'll see. 6:30 to 8:30 on the 25th, the 29th, and the 30th, I believe, are the nights. Okay. So take a look at that if that's something that may be of interest. Okay. All right. Okay. Well, if there's nothing else, thank you all for coming. Hope it was useful.
Thank Ramona, you.
You got, okay.
Thank you.
I don't know when we'll do the next one or what it'll be about, but we'll let you know. We plan to do about one of these a month. And we try to gear them toward more management, financial, that type of thing, rather than operations. So we'll see you next time. Watch our website and our e-newsletter, and hopefully we'll see some of you next time. Okay?
All right.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Take care. Okay.